Now, did your talk. He's at it. We're at it. And even if you had another person, he could slide over a little bit.
Yeah,
and be right.
And put him right here in the middle.
Looks like a radio program.
Everybody's mic. Yep. Yeah, man. Let me get y'all on, man. Since it's the two of y'all, now I'm gonna let y'all.
When did you finish the pool? Was it? You had it on last summer?
Yeah, this 2019.
Okay, so it was doing this time.
Right.
And you were putting it in.
Yeah, they delivered it in November and put it in January.
Mm-hmm.
January, February, and then I had the pavers and all that other stuff done.
You got no geese floating around in that.
No geese so far.
With nothing else.
Yeah.
Long time ago, when I was little, this was one of my kind of friends that built a house and it was brand new. So it was kind of in the woods.
Mm-hmm.
And he had a pool out there. Well, nothing to see a beaver floating in there.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
You know, it was still, he was one of the first houses out there.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I think every day he had to fish a beaver out there.
Mm.
Well, all right, Hampton Roads, get ready, get ready, get ready, get Ricky ready.
Ricky.
Well, don't touch that dial. I've got Dr. James Overton coming on up for you right here. We have a special guest on today, and I'm telling you, they're going to get into a conversation that you don't want to turn that dial. Hey, tune in. It's the Seven Cities Forum right here on WGPL 1350.
Good Monday morning to everyone, and welcome to the Seven Cities Forums. And first of all, thank you, Bishop Edward Johnson. And I want to do something right quick,
mm-hmm.
Bishop.
Yep.
I want you to open us up with a little prayer this
okay.
morning. This is a new year, and I think we should open up our shows with a little prayer, because some of the subjects we talk about, especially when we get into politics, we want to have a prayer in advance for some of the things that's going on out here in this world today. But I appreciate that. Bless us with a prayer, brother.
Well, dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for just allowing us to wake up on today. You've given us the right mind. You've given us clothes and activities of our limbs. And we just thank you on today. We just ask you, Lord God, that whatever our conversation be, let it be of you. Father, let us come to the table and be able to resolve our problems instead of fighting over our problems. On today, I would ask you that you will anoint these two men who would come and to bring you information, to bring us information that we need to know about our cities. I'll pray that our mayor, our city council people would come together and reason together that we, that you may get the glory out of our lives. We thank you for this day and this program. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 Thank you, Lord. I appreciate that. And every day we rise, it's a great day to be alive. And I thank you all for listening and on the radio and those tuning in on Facebook Live this morning. And this morning, of course, my name is James Slim Overton, and my co-host is here, the Colonel Thomas Chapman.
Good morning, Slim. Good morning.
And if you all hadn't heard, he's my new co-host, and he's a colonel, and it just makes sense to have him on here with me to sort of, we're like a dynamic duo, not Batman and Robin, but we do pack a 1-2 punch.
Yes,
I must
indeed.
Say. So, because he's military and we concentrated in the military around here, but we like to hear what his opinions are and we can sort of feed off each other. So we have some things planned in the future. We're going to stay Hampton Roads focused. But we will occasionally, like today, talk about what's going on the national scene, because that trickles down all the way to what goes on locally, especially here in this military area. So I want to say this one thing, too, that this is the time of the year when a lot of the seniors in our high schools are thinking about college. And, well, you should have been a little ahead of this time, but a lot of people are really get serious this time of the year and start putting out those applications, so, and then looking for those scholarships out there. I like to tell the students and the parents, make sure all you have to do is Google. Those scholarships are out there, and a lot of people miss out on them. It might be a scholarship for people who wear glasses. I mean, you know, it's some scholarships out there you wouldn't believe, but they're not going to just come and knock on your door. You have to research for them, so your children can go to college and get some assistance there. And when you're out there, go for the colleges, make those applications, put in a lot of applications, and make sure you consider the HBCUs. They're out there, one in particular, Virginia Union University in Richmond. It's a liberal arts college, and which majors in psychology, communication, biology, and of course, they have that school of theology that offers a PA, a doctor's degree in that. So consider your HBCUs or any college or university. Make sure you get out there and do your research, do your homework, and don't sit back and think you can't afford it or you won't be able to until you won't know until you try. So I just wanted to throw that in there, and thanks everybody. Okay.
Let me jump right on that.
Sure.
I know we're on there when you're talking about the colleges.
Mm-hmm.
So as we know, January 1 just passed, and it just passed. And then so, and we're busy trying to get all those tax documents together.
Mm-hmm.
But I think when you look at affordable, you know, affording the way to go to school, mm-hmm, for colleges and universities is to right away have and do your FAFSA form, the federal student assistance form, where you'll be eligible for those grants from the federal government.
Mm-hmm.
We normally wait too late to do those.
Right.
So soon as you get that tax return done, you need to file for your children's FAFSA form so they'll see what they're going to be qualified for from the federal government. The other thing, mm-hmm, is that we miss out, mm-hmm, is that you can go to your local library or the school library and pick up the College Blue Book.
Mm-hmm. College Blue Book.
The College Blue Book. Mm-hmm. And it has a section in there. They have all the college universities, what they major in, costs,
mm-hmm,
and the other costs, meaning room and board, fees, and all this other thing, broken down across the country. Accredited schools,
right?
And there's a book in College Blue Book for grant scholarships and grants, because we don't want our children saddled with debt for the rest of their lives.
Right, indeed.
So yeah. you want grants. There's something that you don't have to pay back. Scholarships, you don't. All you have to do is get them, and it's money to you or to the school to help you with your room and board, and also your tuition.
Mm-hmm.
So you want to go to school without the and graduate without saddled with the debt.
20-30 year debt.
Yes.
Keeps you from enjoying the fruits of your labor.
Yes. Yeah. Save for law school. You know, if you're going to law school, you know, you may get through law school and got $250,000 worth of debt mm-hmm. that you've got to pay. Or med school is even, yes, a lot of classes and clients that you've got to out there to work. So you're working to pay back that debt. But for the common folks like us, you know, we've got our kids are graduating with $20,000, $30,000, $40,000 worth of debt.
Mm-hmm.
And that is a burden on what you can do when you leave.
Yeah, and you're out there with a college degree in your field and have to get a second job just to make sure that everything is intact. So,
but while you talk about your field, that goes back to what we talked about earlier, is to have that conversation with your children on the degree path or what they want
mm-hmm.
or what they should go. Because it's always nice to pursue something that they love, but you have to look at what is the economic payback for that degree that they're going to get.
Right, right. And of course, we know many people that have those degrees that are working in a completely different field from what they spent their 4 years or
think twice before years. You get that I love me degree. Yeah. Think twice, think three times before you get that I love me degree.
Know what the future in technology or the future in jobs is. I think I saw a report about the future. I can't recall exactly what it was, but they were giving a report where the jobs were going to be in the next 10, 20 years.
Right.
And what fields that kids or students need to be concentrating on.
Mm-hmm, so. Mm-hmm.
And that's what I was talking about, the 1-2 punch. I bring it up and he comes with the information, the detailed information about what we need to do. But parents, consider that. I mean, parents and students, consider that. Make sure you do your homework. This is nothing to play with. I mean, it can be serious. And one other thing, when local civic leagues or groups have these scholarships they offer, go ahead and apply for them. They might be for $500, $250 or whatever. And you say, well, I'm not applying for that. But it adds up. You know, I mean, that could be some books. That could be, nowadays it might be one book. But anyway, but those little scholarships that these groups give away, make sure you apply for them. Don't shy away from them because they might not be in the thousands, but you know they do help you. You'll find out how much they'll help. They might help you start a little bank account once you get on campus. So.
Well, you know, and the other thing with scholarships, and you're talking about parents, and now since our grandparents are raising some of our kids and trying to mm-hmm. subsidize the kids, if you read any financial magazine, mm-hmm. they will say, don't sign, not for the parent or the grandparent, to sign for that school loan.
Mm-hmm.
Because they have to look at for their approaching retirement.
Mm-hmm.
So you need to try to get the free money first.
Yeah.
And if I have to sign for a bunch of school loans, then that might not be an affordable university or school that my child needs to go to.
Right, right. Yeah,
so you have to make those economic decisions.
You have to make those economic decisions, and that's why I say it takes homework. You can't just wait until maybe this time of the year and start looking into these things. You should have started before, but we're just reminding those people who haven't done that, you know, you got some work to do. You need to get out there and find out. And the big name universities might not be for you, even though you might say, well, I want that on my resume. But coming out of some of these HBCUs, you know, look at some of the people who have come out of these HBCUs, Norfolk State, Hampton University, Virginia Union.
And public schools.
And public schools have gone on to do great things.
Yes.
And their names are enshrined in history.
Yes.
And you look at their resume and they went to one of these HBCUs. So consider that.
But last thing, one more thing.
This is an important subject,
yes,
too.
But when you look at school debt, academic debt, up until last Friday, the loans that you got and the debt that you got for going to school mm-hmm. was non-dischargeable under federal bankruptcy laws, mm-hmm. meaning it stuck with you forever.
Mm-hmm.
There was a case that was settled on in the state of New York, where this lawyer went after that case, and he actually got his $200,000 worth of school debt mm-hmm. discharged.
Mm-hmm.
with under bankruptcy laws.
Bankruptcy.
So why should corporations and businesses get their debt written off? And him being a lawyer, challenged it, and it was written off in the state of New York.
Okay, and that might set a precedent.
It may set a precedent, but they will appeal.
Yeah.
Because there's big money in putting people in indentureship.
Yeah.
Because you're indentured, just like in the slave days. And then so there's something to watch in the future.
Working it off.
So yes, you got to work it off. Mm-hmm. So yes, go ahead. I just had to add that one more thing.
Okay.
And that's just something that happened last week in the state of New York.
I'll let you, since you got on an office state shirt, I'll let you finish by saying, behold, what?
The green and gold.
And I will say, for real, the maroon and steel for BUU.
That's what
anyway,
I'm
talking let's
about.
Let's get to the topic we wanted to. We're going kind of like I said, national today, and you know, over the last few weeks, we've been dealing with the decision our commander in chief made to take out the general that they reported that had plans to attack several places, or he had some plans to really do some harm to Americans. So that's fine. They said the guy was a real bad guy. My problem is, going forward, and a lot of things have gone on since that happened, you know, of course, they retaliated to show that they had a little muscle. They got people in the streets protesting against them for what they're doing. So I think that's one of the things Trump is going to try to use to his advantage as well. Say, look, see? But anyway, but things have gone on, and it's kind of confusing about people of reporters, seasoned reporters, they're just trying to find out what exactly, you know, I think it kind of goes back to the time when Bush was in there, when they told us that, you know, story that ended up not being as true.
Yeah,
as
weapons of mass destruction.
Weapons of mass destruction, and he had nothing. I mean, he was just obliterated.
Yes. So, but you know, and we look at General Soleimani. That was under international law, Mr. Trump assassinated the number two political diplomat or number two person for the country of Iran.
Mm-hmm.
And that is the equivalent of them assassinating, if Iran did it, to say Mike Pence, the vice president.
Right.
The same thing.
Same thing.
No other legitimate president ever considered. They considered it, but says would not have done that.
They were confronted. It was brought to their attention, and it was also suggested that might not be a good move.
It was not a good move.
This is not a good move to take out.
Assassinate, not just take out, to assassinate another foreign leader, and it goes against all precedents for the last 5-6.
Regardless of what he's,
we just don't do this in this country.
Yeah.
But most folks are saying, most legitimate news organizations have said this is more of the wag the dog propaganda from the White House, and also listening to state-run TV, Fox.
So how was that? If someone may ask, how is that different from them taking out the president or the leader of Iraq?
We were in war. You know, talking about Saddam Hussein.
Yeah.
We were actually taking him down. We were actually at war at the time with him.
Okay.
Here it is. We're not on a declared war. And so, in the Iranian general, there is no. There's no discussion on he was a bad man, did a lot of bad things, and he was that's clear as mud, and they've always been plotting against the United States and the embassies and that. But when you assassinate them and then come up with the false narrative, or come up with the lies of saying he was going to attack or these attacks were imminent, was just beyond repel. You know that was wrong. You know that was you have to tell the truth. It was the lie of the day, because one, it distracted America and distracted the world against what is happening this week with the impeachment and all my legal problems that I have back here with my corrupt regime.
Yeah, and I think most people with their eyes open see that, you know, but you're getting all this.
America is not most people.
Yeah.
You know, we have a 40% population that is low information voters,
mm-hmm.
and they listen to state-run propaganda by Fox, and we have folks like Lindsey Graham and our warmongers that want to actually go to war and thinking that will make us raise the flag and get re-elections, be re-elected by the president and his cronies.
Well,
the guys carrying the guns don't mean nothing. Military makes nothing. Makes no difference to these people in office today. They could care less. It's all about power.
Because I saw a poll today that said it was like 90-some% of the people that were polled felt that that was the wrong move by the president.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe like 40-some% felt like, you know, what they're doing now, trying to, it looks like a cover up. I mean, you know, they're just trying to throw out different reasons for what they did, because you have all these people in top positions, depending on where they are, what show they are, they're saying one thing. Trump is saying it was four different locations. And all the people want, or the reporters, all they want is the truth. All they want is some transparency. That's
all. We don't have truth in this country.
But we got everybody going. The only people that believe anything is his base.
Right, his base.
You can tell him anything anyway.
And any of those who used to have any respect in this country try to hem and haw and try to hem and haw and go around the edges to say, well, it could have been. But we know they've always been plotting. So, and it's broad based.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, he was plotting for, you know, but nothing was imminent.
How does a soldier that has taken an oath to protect his country and is out there serving, whether he's here in the United States with the possibility of any time being deployed or he's deployed, how does he look at all this and take it in? I mean, you know, from a soldier's perspective, I know he can't speak out and say things, but internally, I mean, this must be with some soldiers, you know, eating at their very core, just looking at this, you know, they just want to serve and do what's right. And they, you know, they see, just like the people that are awake, see all through this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But they are caught right in the middle of it.
Well, those, you know, in uniform,
where at some point it might cost them their lives.
Right. Those in uniform salute the flag, and they will carry out all the orders of the President of the United States and those under him. Bottom line, that's the way the Constitution is written, mm-hmm. and that's the way we do business. And even though we may go back to the hooches and amongst ourselves and say, hey, this is the, long as it is lawful, we have to carry it out. And you have to talk about it. And so I am glad that I am not serving anymore because even when I was in uniform, I had my groups that, you know, I spoke out against, you know, what was going on
mm-hmm.
in the Iraqi war. I always said, you know, that was a farce.
So, I mean,
but I still had to go do my job.
You still had to go do.
But now I'm free.
Now you're free. Now you can talk about it and give us some little insight about what's going on in the mind of a soldier. I was just curious what's going on in the mind of a soldier when you're actually serving, and you explained it, and you explained it before that you have to follow
the orders,
follow lawful orders
of the President of the United States, mm-hmm. and then you go on and do your thing. And then, but there are some that, you know, will bend to the rah-rah and get into the euphoria of the fog of war, and they enjoy it.
And
so there is that segment there that enjoys war, because even in...
one thing, they're not there.
They're not there. But even though some of the, they're not there, but war is a big moneymaker.
Mm-hmm. for a lot
of people. It feeds the defense industry.
Mm-hmm. So, what? Jobs. Yeah, and jobs and everything. So, we talked about the Hampton Roads area, and I don't know what you have in your notes there, or where'd you want to go with that. But I always think about the Hampton Roads area being a high concentration of military, and I always wonder how they look at this. How is it affecting the military, the morale? That's what I want. That's what I was looking for. The morale. I know you said, you have to follow the orders, but you got morale that's going to be a certain. I mean, when you were in, did you see anything like that where you had to sort of, hey, look, soldiers, hold your heads up or something like that? Huh?
You always have to keep the morale up, and you talk to your soldiers and subordinates and, talk to the chain of command and trying to keep everybody's spirits up. Mm-hmm. And a lot of things are not affected, with the deployment of the folks down in North Carolina. We don't see that.
Mm-hmm.
We don't see the effects. But if you go down to Fort Bragg and talk to those spouses, that their loved ones are on a transport and they've been torn away
mm-hmm.
for a political action, what they were told we were coming home, but now they're back on a plane heading back over there to go over there and sit under the guise of protecting our nation, and we know it's a political thing. It is hard on them. It's the same thing as the ones that were torn up and they're sitting in the desert stringing up Constantino wire on federal land, building Mr. Trump's fence that doesn't work. But you got 5,000 troops down there sitting there doing nothing, away from their families, and the fit of political issue.
So is there any kind of political military pact that's out there that could be speaking? I mean, I know it's a lot of retired military brass like yourself that are out there talking or making speeches or something like that, where people can really hear from the soldiers' point of view.
No.
It's have to be little shows like this, and
yes.
When you're allowed to go on national TV, because I see on some of the national TVs they have former generals and
things because they're
that,
free
that really talk.
Yes,
and I can really respect what they're saying because I say these guys know what they were there making those decisions.
Right. Yes.
So they know it's really kind of refreshing, but it looks like sometimes that falls on deaf ears.
Right, because once you're in, when you're in uniform, you toe the line and you keep going. As long mm-hmm. as it's lawful, and you just toe the line and you go for it.
Mm-hmm.
And then once you're retired or you leave service, then and there's no other obligations for you to come back, and you're not divulging any classified information,
mm-hmm.
then you're allowed
to speak up
in this country. And that's your First Amendment right.
Maybe we just need to hear it more because we hear more of Trump's rhetoric than we hear of anything else, and not just from generals, but anybody else trying to speak up and tell the truth. But because he's the president, I mean, the focus is going to be on whatever he says. And sometimes they'd be showing him making mistakes, but they're really giving him, giving him an audience to continue his rhetoric.
Yeah, well, he's a TV man,
yeah.
And he understands.
He knows how to work that.
I need to work. I need to be in front of the TV every day, and it doesn't make it good or bad every day. And I have to talk about it because you talk about him breaking the record of 15,000. He's at over 15,000 lies.
Mm-hmm.
But if you go back to why he does that, Hitler had Mein Kampf. He says, if you tell a lie long enough,
mm-hmm.
more enough, then people will believe. And that's what we believe, or America believes. And so the remedy of this is that we need to rise up at the voting booth in November.
Mm-hmm.
For those who've been thrown off the rolls from Republican areas, you need to get up, make sure that your registrations are up to date. You've got a good call, or either write your...
your city government and saying, am I still on the roll so I can come out there and voice my constitutional right to vote? And we can put them all out, meaning the president and all those senators and representatives, put them out and get a representative government for the future.
That the Constitution intended.
That is the way it is intended. And because if we don't, our way of life that we know of it today will be forever changed, and we cannot go back.
And you know, there's some people out there feel like, well, okay, and then we're talking about the national issues, which I stated earlier, it trickles down to state and then local cities. Mm-hmm. And some people, okay, we can talk about the national issues, and you might not feel like you're heard, at least up there. Mm-hmm. But you can be heard at the state level and on the local level. Right now in the state of Virginia, the General Assembly is in session. Mm-hmm. And this is a long session. They'll be there to March. And people don't realize that you can go there, you have an issue. You know, and it's always buses going up there for certain issues, and you need to be aware where those senators and delegates will come out and talk to you. I mean, a lot of times when they come home and I run into them, they say, well, nobody, you know, well, it's usually the same people that know that they have the right to go there and talk to their senator directly on issues. But that's for anybody to do.
Yeah, they work for us.
They work for you.
They work for us.
And your tax dollars.
And your tax dollars pays their salaries, but they legislate, make up laws for us. And if we don't say anything or write anything or call or anything like that, then the problems that are that come after that from inaction is on us.
Mm-hmm. And I've had her on before, Senator Lucas, while she was in session, and she called in and we had a conversation and talked to her, and I'm going to have her on again and probably get some of the new delegates like Don Scott and maybe some of the other ones that are just starting out in Virginia Beach to have them on here by phone, or if they are in town on a Monday, to come by and give us an update on what's going on. You can always keep up by going online and going into the generalassembly.com, and it gives you an update of what's going on. It might be kind of hard to navigate if you don't know what HB 105 is. I mean, that's House Bill, you know. But talking to your delegates or your senators, they can explain to you what's important to Portsmouth, what's important to Virginia Beach, what's important to Chesapeake. Because there's a lot of bills up there that probably are dealing with Northern Virginia, something mm-hmm. like that. So to navigate through that might be kind of hard, but it's important that you talk to them. Or if you can't get to them, they have assistants and representatives that are well-versed in what's going on about the localities they represent. So
yes.
Let's just take advantage of that. And we're going to do our part to try to bring as much information about what's going on throughout the session. Mm-hmm. And hopefully one of the things when they come on, it will satisfy some of the questions you might have.
Right. See, and we always come and we'll protest or we say a lot of things that things are wrong after the fact. Mm-hmm. We look at, we cry about the toll situation. And the tolls are going up in the downtown tunnel.
Mm-hmm. They're already up.
They're already up. And we didn't have to even have a toll. Mm-hmm. Because if they would have passed the, I think it was 3 or 5 cent gas tax 10 years ago.
Yeah.
Then they would have had enough money to build that tunnel and more, and do all the construction on these highways. They would have had the money and more than enough to do what they had to do.
And that was all caused by misinformation or not the right information getting out to people. Mm-hmm. I remember that going on. Senator Lucas was back there then, and I think she was trying to push for that.
Yes.
And some other people that were there. And the people that didn't want it either had more money to put out there or they were more vocal in pushing their agenda. and people went along with that, which is, if you had a really researched the information, you could have seen clearly how advantageous that would have been at that time, and 10 years later, we wouldn't be where we are today.
Well, you know what? We've always been on the the Republican Party has been on an anti-tax an agenda. And so taxes, nobody likes to pay taxes, but taxes is what keeps us from being a third world country. Mm-hmm. So you're talking about agendas. The governor at the time had their agenda and had his minions saying, oh, we don't want to raise taxes, even though it's 3 to 5 cents a gallon and on your gallon of gasoline, which nobody would have felt. Mm-hmm. I'm going to give those construction contracts to my boys in Florida, and now we have to pay these tolls for, I believe now it's down to another 51 years. Mm-hmm. Just think, you got another 51 years to pay for the deals.
And it's in the contract, they can go up each year.
They go up each year.
A percentage each year.
Yes.
And the way the contract reads, they can go up each year if they need to. But they're going to need to every year.
Yes.
It's not going to be a year where they say, oh, we're not going up this year. Mm-hmm. It's going to be some increase every mm-hmm. year for mm-hmm. about 51 years.
And they made it ironclad. You can't pay it off early. They just took you.
Well, by the time it gets really up there, I'll be crawling anyway, so mm-hmm. I won't have to yeah. worry about that. But I am concerned about the future.
You know, yeah, that's future. Why you have, you know, that's why you get, you know, look at this anti-tax regime that's in with the, that's guided by the Republican Party. Mm-hmm. Same thing with the new, the Jobs Act that they passed.
Yeah, thanks. And unfortunately, we come to another half hour.
It's half hour already.
Yes, you know how it is. We have
Lord
fun.
Have mercy.
We have fun. But anyway, we thank you for listening today, and thank you for watching on Facebook. And for those who just tuned in, of course, you're listening to James Slim Overton and the Colonel Thomas Chapman on WGPL 1350 AM on your dial. And join us every Monday at 6:30 AM for the Seven Cities Forums of Hampton Roads. And we really appreciate you joining us. And again, we thank the Bishop, Edward Johnson, for his hospitality in his little space here. And we thank you, and thank you for listening. And God bless you, and we'll see you next week. And remember, be aware, be informed, and most of all, be involved. Thank you.
How you like that? We went off into other subjects, and then you know it's good.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, that's what I wanted to do with just us here. We didn't know. But I wanted to. Thanks everybody for watching. I tip my hat to you.